Donc bonjour à tous. Donc tout d'abord, je m'excuse pour parler en italien, mais
good morning. And I apologize for not speaking Italian, but you see, my Italian is very limited, so I will address you in French, and I will tell you about the parameters of the impact of fermentation parameters on fermentative aromas. It is esters and superior alcohols. They have been identified for some time now. We know about their synthesis, and yet we do not know about complex regulations and their function during fermentation in terms of their relationship with temperature, which means that this is all very complex. It is not easy to say, I simply add this amino acid in order to produce that alcohol. And therefore, we need to understand more and to have a better integrated new approach in order to have a better understanding of these aromas. 10 years ago or so, in my research group and in comparison with Pesch-Kuge colleagues, we developed, therefore, what you see there, which is a linear monitoring system for aromas using gas chromatography. You have here part of the gas in the head part of the machine, which is pumped through heated pumps or lines in order to avoid condensation. Then it is condensed and analyzed using gas chromatography. We have therefore data that are obtained at time intervals of 1 hour, and which make it possible to give us indications about the aromas and also the kinetic aspect of this, which means that we do not simply make a balancing of aromas. Thanks to this constant monitoring examination and the fact that we work during the gas phase, we have very important data. In our laboratories, we focus on the liquid phase, since wine is consumed in the liquid phase. During the gas phase, we see how much quantity is lost, and I can tell whether 10% or 15% is lost. We talk about molecules here. Thanks to constant and continuous monitoring, we can also calculate total quantity which is produced by the yeast, irrespective of the fact that the aroma is kept and preserved into the liquid in the next phase, therefore, or which is lost during the gaseous phase. I will not dwell upon details, but these are the data that we obtain. Here you have three temperatures, 18, 24, 30 degrees centigrade, and this is the total loss out of the total fermentation. The first thing that you see is that there is an increase as temperature increases. You might say this is normal, and this validates the fact that we can make a balance. So there is a variation depending on the constituent. For superior alcohols, it is low, and we have temperatures which are in the frame that you saw up there, while with esters, we lose between 15 and 25% at 18 degrees. For the previous group, it was approximately 0.5%, and we go up to higher percentages for esters at 30 degrees. Irrespective of the must juice that you use, at this temperature, which is 30 degrees centigrade, you lose half of the esters produced. You are left with some, but this means that the yeast has produced huge quantities, and you are left with half of them. At 30 degrees, you lose the esters, you keep superior alcohols, and this means an imbalance between the two compounds. Yet another way to look at things is the following. If you consider the kinetic development of production, on the left-hand side, you have accumulation in the liquid, and on the right-hand side, you see total production, that is the adding together of loss and concentration, the sum of loss and concentration. This is the same juice as at three different temperatures. At 30 degrees, which is in orange, there is a threefold fold lower production of esters when compared to 18 degrees. If I consider total production between 18 and 24 degrees, there is no difference in terms of quantity produced. At 30 degrees, a bit less is produced, but not one third. So the fact that there is this reduction is linked to a slight change in the metabolism of yeasts and also a higher loss due to evaporation. The message here being that it is not so that at 30 degrees no esters are produced. They are produced, but you lose half of them, irrespective of the must. And it is something that you invariably have. It is a physical phenomenon. You cannot counter. There is another possible perspective. Here we had fermentation starting at 15 degrees up to 30 degrees and monitored the loss and accumulation in the liquid for isobutanol, or alcohol, and for ethyl ethanoate, which is an ester. So this is the situation. For superior alcohols, you have this loss, which is approximately 1%, meaning that the quantity produced is to be found in the liquid in blue, while with esters, the quantity that I find in the end in the liquid is hardly half of what the yeast had produced. You lose, again, half of it. Accumulation in the liquid stops earlier on. So at the end of the fermentation, provided that temperature is high, too high, everything which is produced by yeasts is lost due to evaporation. If you do not keep temperature under control, if fermentation occurs at too high temperature, then all aromas produced by the yeast are lost due to evaporation, which means that their production is useless, basically. Here you have the final concentrations with this balance of esters, and we see the impact of temperature on alcohols and esters. There you have the production of propanol and the other alcohols, as is the case with isobutanol and phenyl ethanol, depending on the temperature. With the exception of phenyl ethanol, which reaches an optimum and then has this trend with a lower concentration, in the case of the other alcohols, the higher the temperature, the bigger the production. And the opposite applies to esters, being them acetate or ethyl acetates. Other acetate. Anyway, with an increase in temperature, you have a lower production due to evaporation, as we saw, and not due to a different metabolic mechanism. Please focus on the fact that at 28 degrees centigrade, I have many alcohols and many esters, which means that the style of the wine changes completely, depending on the temperature that I will set. Another parameter that we investigated is the initial concentration of nitrogen. Here you see that with the exception of propanol, there is a concentration which is ideal, at which the production of alcohol reaches a peak, and it is in between 200 and 250 milligrams of nitrogen. Beyond that point, there is a reduction. The opposite holds true for esters, all of them. The higher the content initially of a nitrogen, the higher the content of esters at the end. So if you supply a lot of nitrogen, you have a sharp increase in esters and with this trend. So once again, as was the case with temperature, you change the style of the wine. We asked ourselves what would happen if we combined everything with nitrogen, which is what you see there. We investigated three different temperatures, 18, 24, and 30 degrees centigrade, and three levels of nitrogen, low in black, medium in blue, and orange means high levels. You see that we can form these groups depending on the presence of nitrogen. Higher the presence of nitrogen, higher the production of esters. And here I move to the other graph. You see that the prevailing effect is that of nitrogen. vis-à-vis temperature. And yet temperature does perform and play a role in that the higher the temperature, the easier it is to go from low levels to high levels in terms of superior esters or alcohol, sorry. So there is a strong interaction between the two parameters that should be managed together. The best thing to do is to focus on these two points. We have M, which coincides with a medium concentration of nitrogen at 18 degrees, and H, which stands for high concentration of nitrogen at 30 degrees. These are very close, the two points. They almost overlap, which means that we have the same aromatic composition. And some people say that you should give a lot of nitrogen in order to maximize esters. But if I do not control temperature, and if I'm at 30 instead of 18, this nullifies what I did with nitrogen. You can't simply add nitrogen and forget about all the rest. You have to keep the two things under control together in order to maximize the esters of the molecules you are interested in function of the style of wine that you want to obtain. So you know what recipe should be applied here. After investigating this interaction, we focused on yet another one, which is the interaction between nitrogen and lipid phytosterols of wine, which are present in lees and in solid particles, which remain after the removal of the lees. So for alcohols, you see that here we have a solution or medium, which is poor in nitrogen. And we have the same situation respective of the fact that we have 2 or 8 milligrams of lipids per liter. On the other hand, when I have a lot of nitrogen, again, we have a higher content of lipids coinciding with a higher presence of alcohols. Vice versa, if you consider acetate and ethyl esters, when there are low levels of nitrogen, nothing changes, more or less, depending on or in relation to lipids. But if I increase nitrogen, then I have more lipids and less esters, which means that in order to have a lot of esters, I have to remove lees more than I would normally do. And this means that I have to have things clearly under control. If I clarify excessively my juice, then I will run the risk of having difficulties in completing fermentation. You will have residual sugar, and you will not be able to sell your wine. You have to be very careful in managing this phase. So once again, you have to manage everything at the same time, and especially so when I have a high nitrogen level. In the beginning, here you see what happens when you try and combine lipids, nitrogen, and temperature. These works were performed together with Lallemand on the occasion of a dissertation by Rolero starting in 2015 and until 2018. This is phenyl ethanol. And you see how the curves are combined. This is production of phenyl ethanol. This is the impact of lipids and nitrogen and temperature and lipids. I have, therefore, an optimum production of phenyl ethanol for 200 milligrams of nitrogen. This is what I read from the graph. It is a sort of magic recipe. If I wanted to have a lot of phenyl ethanol, I can play with the other levels of the other variables, while with isoamyl acetate, it is not that there is one optimum situation, but I can tell that the higher the temperature, the better. I have, though, a negative effect on accumulation. So This has to be taken into consideration as well. And here we have for acetate esters, we have a less marked effect for a nitrogen. The effect of temperature is more significant. We have a more negative effect for lipids following the removal of the lees. Here I concentrated on the three molecules, but I stress once again the importance of coordinating management of the three parameters. You have to find the right formula, but this is very complex, and you understand that. I'm not giving you a recipe which you can simply apply and make a good wine. I don't even try to do that. I simply want to give indications in terms of the styles of wines that you can obtain. Then we asked whether this was true for all strains. Well, a priori, it is so. The Cerevisiae strains that we focused on had this trend. You see that the shape, the surface is more or less the same. Phytosterols and nitrogen have the same impact on production, while in the case of non-saccharomyces strains, here you have a totally different shape, which means that the production of phenyl ethanol for this strain is highly different. This holds true also for the S5 strain that we saw there. This works for all strains, as I said, with the exception of non-saccharomyces strains, whereby we have to have a more specific investigation. I'm about to conclude. We asked whether the adding of nitrogen at the beginning of fermentation had the same impact or not. And this is what we show here. We added nitrogen in the form of amino acid, ammonium, at one-third of the fermentation process, and we saw that there is no impact on the production of isoamylic acid. If I do the very same thing, same quantity, but I examine isoamyl acetate, I have an increase of from 1 to 4 or 5, depending on the quantity of nitrogen. So administering nitrogen in this moment is important, and giving organic nitrogen has a higher impact. If I compare and contrast this with the initial quantities, you see that here I am between 2 and 3, and here it is 4 and 5. So if I want to add nitrogen, I know that I have to give it or supply it one-third through the process. We therefore asked what happens during fermentation. Alcohols unaltered, esters do change. What about the metabolic processes? When you give and add nitrogen, you stimulate bioconversion in a significant way. Of superior alcohols into acetate esters, and there is an increase in the transcription of two genes, which is ATF1 and 2, which are responsible for esterification activities, which are stimulated after giving a nitrogen. So there is an impact, and we managed also to explain the mechanism which is associated to this major stimulation. This is my very last slide. Here we tried to devise strategies for two strains, strain A and B. Well, when I supply nitrogen during the stationary phase, this is more effective because you have a higher production of acetate esters. Here you have the same effect, but each and every strain preserves its own style with a different production level of esters. So even with the nutritional stimulation, I obtain the same effect, which is the fact that the two strains keep their properties. It is not that I standardize in a way or level the styles of the wine. I would like now to add that you really need to combine nitrogen together with the other parameters. You have to pick the right source of nitrogen, if it is ammoniacal nitrogen or not. And you also have to manage temperatures, the moment when you add, the rate of removal of lees. You can't simply say, I manage nitrogen and temperature and forget about all the rest. Because by doing so, you will not have the aromatic result that you want to have, and you will be disappointed. In addition to that, you certainly saw that the conditions change in terms of being optimum for the production of superior alcohols and esters. And temperature does have an impact on the two major families of molecules. In addition to that, you have to strike a balance. You have to find a compromise between fermentation kinetics and the production of aromas. Depending on the temperature, at low temperature, you have an increase in esters and an increase in the duration of fermentation. The first part is good for aromas, but the second part entails that depending on the number of tanks that I have in my winery and the quantity of grapes that ripen simultaneously, I will need to decide whether I can afford such a long fermentation or not. It can possibly be that I have to purchase new tanks. And then turbidity, its reduction is good for the accumulation of esters with more aromatic wines. But if you reduce it excessively, then you run the risk of having a first problem, which is the accumulation of volatile acidity and acetic acid, which is not good per se. And you also have the risk of having slow fermentation or stops in fermentation, which is not good in terms of residual sugar. What I told you about aromas works, but please pay attention to the fact that you have to find the right compromise between all these parameters. Thank you, in the end, to the people that are mentioned there from In Rare and L'Allemand. Thank you so much.